epithelial cells, which up until then were considered to be signs of contamination of the urine, mm-hmm. we managed to prove that they're coming from the bladder and they're a marker of cystitis going on.
Let's go back a little bit to the actual diagnosis. You mentioned that you use a microscope and fresh spun urine. Yeah. Can you just tell me what you're looking for there and how that helps you diagnose an infection?
Right. Okay. Well, the key, well, first of all, a caveat, it's the symptoms that give you the diagnosis. Mm-hmm. Okay. Definitely. The maths of this is such that the symptoms and the signs over and over again give you the diagnosis. Now, if you get an inflammatory reaction in the bladder wall and it's exuberant enough, then you will leak white blood cells into the urine. Now, what we discovered was that those white blood cells will, once they're into the urine, they will die quite quickly, and then they will lyse, that's break up quite quickly. And so if you just send a urine up to the laboratory, an awful lot of it will have dissipated. Mm-hmm. The signal will have dissipated by the time it gets there. At these places where they're sending the urine and it's examined the following day is useless.
Yeah.
And we found that within two hours, the white cell count has dropped to about 60% of its starting point. So we instituted this process. Now we've got to look at this fresh, absolutely fresh. So we use immediately fresh urine. And we copy what was done in 1928. You put a drop of urine onto a special slide that's got special engravings on it. So it's called a counting chamber. And then you look down the microscope and you count the white cells. And the thing about counting the white cells is it can be hugely helpful in plotting the course of the disease afterwards. Mm-hmm. So we will use the white cell count to plot the graphs of the white cell count to plot the course of the disease and graphs of the symptom scores to plot the course of the disease. Mm-hmm. And then while we were doing this work, we discovered that the epithelial cell counts in the urine were also elevated in these patients, most of them, not all of them, and that those epithelial cells, which up until then were considered to be signs of contamination of the urine, we managed to prove, no, they're coming from the bladder, and they're a marker of cystitis going on, and it's part of the innate immune response, and you're shedding lots of epithelial cells. So we also count the epithelial cells nowadays. Now, the counts are not so important to us. It's the pattern in the graph that's really important. And that can be important where we got someone on treatment and they say, well, my symptoms aren't getting any better. Mm-hmm. And in the past, I used to change the medication thinking it wasn't working. But if we got a graph of the white cells and it shows that it's going in the right direction, we're then able to say, hold it. This is improving. And if we stick in here, the symptoms will follow. And that's enabled us to reduce the amount of antimicrobial prescribing that we do.
Okay. Given that the dilution of the urine could impact those cell counts, how do you advise patients so that you can get a consistent sample each
time? You don't have to. You see, the thing is, gravity comes to your rescue. Now, in fact, it's so important that in the book, I have got some drawings to show this of the bladder. When you look into infection in the urine, it's like a snowstorm. So there are all these cells cascading down and they accumulate at the base of the bladder. So in fact, you have these debris all sitting there at the base of the bladder. And when you pee, out it comes.
Right.
And so there's no dilutional effect at all. You just get it coming up.
That you have to catch the first stream rather than the midstream?
Yeah, well, we've studied that as well. And we found that the midstream urine specimen is missing a huge chunk of the pathological signal. So nowadays, we just say, look, here's a bowl, pee into it. All right. And that's what we use. And in fact, it's amazing. The thing is that we have all grown up with habits of peeing.
Mm-hmm.
And most people are very consistent in the way that they pee. They do the same thing every time. And as a result of that, an individual's counts can be hugely consistent and enable us to monitor the progress of the disease, right? So we don't, oddly enough, the dilutional effect doesn't come through. Isn't that nice?
Yeah, that is interesting. A lot of people can't access this kind of diagnostic method. So in that case, can they use symptoms alone, or is standard urine culture ever helpful?
In fact, in my view, the symptoms are, I keep saying it, the symptoms are the best guide to all of this. Mm-hmm. Now, the trouble is that it's nerve-wracking. I've got to give that. While COVID broke, we were not able to get the microscopy mm-hmm. that we could do. So we were managing on symptoms a great deal. And 80% of the time, that was great. But where we ran into difficulties were the patients who were getting acute flares or feeling it wasn't going fast enough mm-hmm. or were distressed and so on. And I was finding that I was changing the antibiotic. And after a while, when we looked back and looked at our data on aggregate, I could see clusters of shuffling antibiotics. And I realized that the problem was that we were not getting the urine analysis.
Mm-hmm.
And that would, if I'd seen the plots of the urine right. analysis, I wouldn't have changed the treatment. So what we instituted was to say, okay, send your urine off to the local laboratory, send us back the report, ignore the culture result, but tell us what the white cell and epithelial cell count showed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very crude option, but we've been able to muddle through a bit using that.
Okay.
And some labs have cooperated by taking the urine, allowing people to provide the urine fresh, and they run it through the machines and we get an early answer.
What advice do you have for patients who do have plenty of UTI tests, but they always come back negative and they don't have access to a protocol or an approach like yours?
Yeah, I understand that. I mean, this is the problem about progress, is that we're a specialized scientific unit. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, we're as far as I can make out, we seem to be the only clinical scientific unit really working on this big time in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why I wrote the book, in fact, was to try and encourage my profession to recognize that the tests a non-starter and you've got to go by the symptoms. And I'm hoping that'll change. The advice that I can give people at the moment is to take Hyperx, methenamine. Now, the point being is you can get Hyperx over the counter. You don't need a prescription. And it'll work. It's incredibly slow in its working, but it does the right thing. And the reason for this is that it turns your urine into a disinfectant.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've got a chronic infection and you're shedding the epithelial cells, that's great. That's the immune system doing what you want it to do. Now, if you turn your urine into a disinfectant, it means that when you've shed these cells and the microbes wake up and try and mount an escape, they will be confronted with a urine that's disinfectant. And that will curtail a lot of their escape attempts. Now, it's imperfect.
Mm-hmm.
It hasn't got the power of the penetration of the antibiotic. But if you stick at it, that can make an enormous difference.
Hyperx is actually prescription only in some places in the world. I know it's available in others over the counter, but not everywhere. So there is issues accessing that. But maybe we can talk a little bit more about your actual treatment approach. You touched on the fact that you tend to use first generation narrow spectrum antibiotics.
Yes.
I wanted to just confirm that is at a full dose, not a prophylactic dose.
Okay. Yeah. The other thing is that the prophylactic dose, years ago, I started with the prophylactic doses and the results were atrocious, absolutely atrocious. And, there's no two ways about it, it's not going to work. And then when we started doing the real heavy duty science, we realized that there was an enormous problem with penetration of the antibiotic. So we're going to use the full dose. And in fact, we will try and use the maximum permitted dose within the tolerance of the patient, right? Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you something, that when we start on the full dose, we'll sometimes see patients who will describe trough effects. So I have patients coming in saying, oh, well, you know, everything's all right until I'm coming up to my next dose. And then I feel awkward, and then I take the dose, and then my symptoms clear again. Initially, I thought that this is just wacky. I don't believe this and so on. But eventually, when we did some studies, we found, my God, these people are talking correct. Mm-hmm. So we dealt with that partly by splitting the doses up so they go four times a day of the day.
Right.
When we see trough effects in people nowadays, we'll increase the dose because it's a signal which is not giving enough, right? Okay. And it's wearing off. So you've got to get a real grip on it. So yes, it is the full dose.
Okay. And in what percentage of patients would you combine the antibiotic with Hyperx, which I know is often the approach?
100% nowadays, if we can. So mm-hmm. what we'll do, now the trouble with Hyperx is if you've got a rampant inflammation going mm-hmm. in your urinary tract and you take Hyperx, then it burns you because right. it's an acidic drug. So we always start the antibiotic first. Mm-hmm. And then we get the people to accommodate to that. And then after 2 weeks, we ask them to make their first attempt with the Hyperx. Now, some right. of them can take to it like a duck to water. It doesn't bother them. But quite a lot of people say, oh, God, that caused burning. So we say, fine, don't do anything more with Hyperx for 4 weeks and then try it again mm-hmm. and stay with one tablet and build it. And then you keep on trial and error. Elimination is the thing. And in the past, I made mistakes by just sort of writing can't tolerate Hyperx. And I learned the hard way that, in fact, that's not the case. You can eventually allow them to get onto it because it's an important drug. And the other thing about Hyperx is it enables us to get them off antibiotics much quicker than we did before we were using Hyperx 100%.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Are there any antibiotics that you cannot take with Hyperx?
Sulfonamides, it's not a good idea to take.
Why is that?
Because they can crystallize in the urine, and so that there's a risk of forming stones. And in fact, it's quite interesting. This we've tumbled into this recently because in the UK there's been a deficiency or there's a supply problem with trimethoprim, mm-hmm. and so as compensation, we were forced back onto Ceftriaxone and Bactrim, which consists of trimethoprim and the sulfonamide, sulfamethoxazole. And we'd completely forgotten about this contraindication. Mm. So we got various sort of slightly, are you sure you know what you're doing type emails? And Harry Beck said, no, I'm not sure. We got this wrong. It can crystallize. So don't take sulfonamides with it. But otherwise, that's it. No,
okay. It's fine. We often get the question about Hyperx forming formaldehyde in the bladder.
Yeah.
Do you have any concerns around that?
No. The thing is that, once again, it's this could, formaldehyde can have carcinogenic properties on mm-hmm. the bladder. But this was noticed in people working in an industry where they were exposed to extraordinarily high concentrations of formaldehyde, and the formaldehyde excretion in the urine was extremely high. Nothing, not anything like the small amounts that appear in the urine. Mm-hmm. And Hyperx has been around for a very long time. 1889, it first got invented mm-hmm. by the French. Okay. And it was then used throughout the first half of the 20th century as you know, the only means of using urine infection. And it was used quite a lot after that. There no incidence of cancers come out of that. And the manufacturers don't believe this is a risk. And I agree with them. I don't think that there is.
That's good to know.
So it's a remarkably safe drug, actually. Remarkably safe.